If you have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the book of Philippians, Philippians chapter 4, and we're going to begin reading in the very first verse. Philippians chapter 4, Paul writing to the church at Philippi, the Bible says, "Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, and Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men, the Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, my brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things." I'd like to preach, the Lord be my helper this morning, on the thought, is there any praise in you? Dear Lord, we thank you for your blessed Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We praise you for him this morning. Lord, we praise you for the strength that lies within you. Lord, we praise you for all and everything that we see about us, Lord, and we know how good and how merciful and how kind you really are. We praise you, the Holy Ghost, that is makes these things real to us from time to time. Lord, we pray this morning that we would be found in a praise situation, Lord, that we would praise you and give you glory. Lord, we pray for the lost, Lord, that today would be the day that you'd manifest yourself to them, and Lord, that you would save them by your goodness and mercy. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Now, I want you to notice a number of things. First of all, that Paul is writing to a true church. He's writing to the church at Philippi, a church that he had preached, and the Lord saw fit to honor his word and save folks. And a church was organized there at Philippi, and he's writing back to them. And you know, we as the Lord's people, very frequently, we have to be reminded of some things. And we have to be encouraged in some things. And sometimes we just need a renewing. And that's what Paul was doing as he wrote to the church at Philippi. He's closing his letter out, and he says, "Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for." Now, I just want you to notice for a moment and ask yourself honestly and answer yourself honestly, do you long for the people at New Testament Baptist Church? Do you desire to be with them? Because, see, Paul's situation was this, that he longed for the fact to hear from them. He longed for the fact to be with them. He desired very much that he might see them again in the flesh. Don't know if that happened, but he wanted it. My joy. See, it was a joyful thing that those people were a joy to him. Now, again, you can answer yourself better than me. It's the people that sets about you this morning. This is New Testament Baptist Church. Are they a joy to you, or are they a hindrance to you? Are they a joy or a happiness or an encouragement, or do they bring you down? We ought to be a joy. The remembrance that Paul had of the believers at Philippi, it was a great encouragement to him. It meant something to him when he thought of where they were at in the Lord. So stand fast in the Lord. He wanted them to continue. And that's my desire for New Testament Baptist Church, is just to stay in fast. In fact, the Bible says, I think he's writing to the church at Colossae, he says, having done all to stand. He gave them a very pointed thing to do and said, even if you get it all accomplished, having done all to stand. That's not advancing. That's not making. And we should make forward motions, but you know what? We should never go backward. Having done all to stand. And that should be our desire, not to let the little things go. And sometimes we do. Sometimes these things of this world grab the upper hand, and what really is important we leave to the side. We need to be careful that we don't do that. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be the same mind in the Lord. Now, one thing that the devil dearly loves to do is to put a dissension in the church, because there's safety and strength in numbers. Now, I don't know what Euodias had against Syntyche and vice versa, but I do know this. It must have been producing some issues in the church, because Paul made direct mention of them. Wouldn't it be a sad thing if somebody wrote to the church at Dover and said, you know what, Syntyche, Euodias, watch what you're doing. But see, it might be Larry, Terry, watch what you're doing. See, we don't like to get down to specifics, but sometimes Paul did. He named them out and said, Euodias, Syntyche, I beg you, I beseech thee, make that thing right. The church don't need it. You don't need it. Make it right. And I want you to see, because we're going to be talking about praising God, if those things exist, you cannot praise Him. Not really. You cannot go before the throne of the Lord when you have something like this in the back of your mind. Verse 3. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, meaning the pastor, help those women which labored with me in the gospel. Now, when he said help them, he didn't mean to give them a handout. He didn't mean to give them some food. You know what will help you more than anything this morning? If I preach you the truth and not a lie. That will help you more than any kind of money I could pull out of my pocket. Helping people is telling them the truth. Helping people is telling them, listen, you need to be saved. You need to be born again. Listen, hell is a reality, and you need to think about it. That me shooting straight with you is the very best thing that I can do for you. Now, ladies, I want you to see that they helped in the gospel. Now, I don't know exactly what they did. I believe that they maybe fixed meals for Paul. I believe they went house to house and said, listen, Paul's preaching down here. Come down to the house of God and hear something besides what the Jews are teaching. Hear something besides the routine. Paul is preaching the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, so he encouraged them in that. He also says, with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with my fellow laborers, whose name are in the book of life. Now, Paul had been so convinced of this group at Philippi, he was pretty certain of their salvation, because he says, their names are in the book of life. And you know what? That was authored before time began. The Lord God Jehovah wrote those names down before you even were and before I was. And he got them written down. And he says, you've convinced me that you're there. Now, how did he convince them? They were serving God. They were serving the church there at Philippi. And they were doing what the Lord had called them to do. That's pretty convincing stuff, ain't it? Now, we live in a day and age where that's blowed off, and all you have to do is show up when you want to and do what you please. But the Bible does not teach that. Verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Now, I want you to see this is very specific directions. Number one, it has to be in the Lord. It has to be in the person of Christ. Now, rejoice is kind of like a recoil on the gun. When you shoot it out, what this is just the recoil. The forward motion has done happened, and you're feeling the recoil from it. Now, to have rejoicing, you have to have joy to start with. And some people I go to and preach look like they are the most miserable, discouraged people in the world. You know what? And I guess this may be fleshly and carnal. I get sick of seeing it. I really do. And the reason they don't rejoice, they never issue some joy to start with. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faith. Those are the fruits of the Spirit. And how can we possibly rejoice when we never issued no joy to start with? When we look like somebody sucking on persimmons. There's no joy in that. No happiness, no gladness. And I believe what that's the problem today. It's not. I believe what hinders our praise the most is we don't have no joy, and certainly we can't rejoice if we have no joy to start with. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Now, listen, we need to be moderate in all things. You know what? As much as we think we do, we don't need no four-bedroom brick with seven baths in it. We don't. You know what that is? It's a signal of pride. That's what it is. You know what would be more moderate? A three-bedroom with one bath. Just stand at the hall and wait till your turn. That's all I know to tell you. See, we need to be a moderate people. And the reason why, it's not that we need to bum each other out. We've got money. We need money to spend on other things. Eternal things. And I tell you what, ladies, and you know better than me, it takes longer to clean seven bathrooms than it does one. See, we need to be moderate. We need to be a people that has time to focus on eternal things instead of carnal things. And the way we do that is to be moderate. Verse 6, be careful in nothing. Now, that is a problem of the Lord's churches today. Well, we better not get too wild in that. We'll be called this and we'll be called that. Well, the Bible says be careful in nothing. You know what? If you get the mind of God and He says start a Christian school, you need to know what you need to do. You need to start a Christian school. I can't do that. But you know you're doing? You're being moderate. I mean, you're being controlled by circumstance. We need to just take God's word for what it is. We need to move forward. You know why churches just stand and rot? Because apparently they don't believe the word of God. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. Now, I've said this, I know you're sick of hearing it, but supplication is where we fail miserably. You know what? We're all about prayer. Lord, give me a new home. Lord, heal me of my cancer. Lord, do this for so-and-so. Give Harry a job. But we never, ever, ever say, blessed be the Most High Redeemer of all things. Goodness, mercy, and faith follow those that believe in Him. He sits at the right hand of the Father. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Praise be unto the Holy Ghost. Our Father, our God, Jehovah, blessed be your name. Now, if you said that in most churches, you would be labeled everything but a Baptist. Right? But we are to supplicate, are we not? In fact, in the model of prayer, I think there's six or seven words that addresses needs. And the rest of it's praise. Right? And so we see then, as the Lord encourages this church, he says, listen, what you need to do is supplicate more and focus on what the Lord has given you. Verse 7, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Now, I want you to see, a lot of people will get this out of whack, but it's don't get the idea that when it says the peace of God will keep your heart, that the peace of God is in fact redemption. But the peace of God which passeth all understanding is this: no matter what happens, my God is in control. No matter what goes on, God is still God. Keep your mind. You know what? That's those people who don't go, whoo, man, we bombed Iraq this week. I wonder what the next thing's going to be. You know what? Down in North Korea, they bombed this morning. They shot off a bomb. It was a complete disaster, but they shot one off. Let me wring my hands a little bit more. You know what? All I can say is you're not trusting God. See, people who trust God, even when the Category 5 hurricane is coming, you'll say, well, blessed be the name of the Lord. Because you know why? He gives us a peace that passeth all understanding when we're near to Him.
Yeah.
Now, it can be
that
that's just an indicator that you're not near as you need to be.
It
can be just a, you know, it's not that you lost, you just don't trust Him. It's not that you lost, you just hadn't heard from Him in a while. And a lot of people get in that situation. Verse 8, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true. You know what's true? The Lord God of all heaven. You know what's true? The Word of God. You know what? I see a lot of people getting messed up today that say they believe the truth. And you know what? It all goes back to right this, when they begin to question this blessed old book. You know what? God being my helper, when you lay me out here in this cemetery, this is what I'll still be believed. You know what? I'm not upset over the translation. I'm not upset that King James was involved, and I'm not upset over the word assembly and church. Don't bother me! You know why? Because I have faith this is the book for English-speaking people, and I'll go on with it. And you know what? If you begin to chip away at this, there's nothing left. Nothing left. If you begin to doubt this, listen, you'd have to doubt the truths that are within it. And certainly we as the Lord's people do not need to be that. It puts you on a very shaky ground. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest. You know what? We need some honest preachers today, do we not? I'm not here to tell you this morning how good you are. But I am here to tell you we serve a resurrected Savior.
Amen.
I am here to tell you that the great God Jehovah detests sin. I am here to tell you that God mediates through the person of the Holy Ghost. And if you don't know the Holy Ghost, you don't know God. Behold, I send you a comforter.
Yeah.
And so, I'm telling you the truth this morning. I'm telling you the truth, if God doesn't intervene, we're people most miserable. I'm telling you the truth this morning, lost people still split hell wide open. And we don't need to sugarcoat that for anyone. Whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Now, I want you to see that Paul makes a very unusual statement. He says, if there be any praise. You know what that says to me? That it's a possibility, even at the church at Philippi, that it might not be there. If there be any praise. And you know what? By him saying if, it had to be a possibility that there wouldn't be. And you can see how he begins chapter 4, that division, if you will, in the Philippian letter, by complimenting them. But even in complimenting them, he wasn't assured that there would be praise even at Philippi. If. So I ask you this morning, have you praised him? Have you given him glory today? Have you lifted up his name? Have you thought this morning how blessed and good our Redeemer really is? That's praise. And you know what? Men, it's to be audible from you and me. It's to be something that other people can hear. The Bible says, in I think it's 2 Peter, I would that you would lift holy hands. You know what? You do that in most churches today, you'll be labeled a Pentecostal. The Bible also says, is any sick among you? Let him call the elders of the church, and he may be anointed with oil. I've heard people tell me, good people, people that you would know if I said their voice, that that was figurative. Well, how do they get that? Isn't it amazing how people want to pick out things that are figurative and things that are true? Well, listen, unless the Bible says that he spake unto them parables, I have to go with what it says, what it is, and means what it says. Right? I don't know any way to interpret that but that. And so today, we as the Lord's people, we have to understand this little if statement into a very sound, good church, if there be any praise among you. Now, I say this to, and I ask you this, is there any praise among you? Is there any praise among you? Is there any praise among you? Among you, is there any praise at New Testament Baptist Church? Because apparently, there's a possibility that it might not be. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21. The Lord Jesus Christ, you saw a great deal of praise in his day. Matthew 21, and we're going to read just verse 14. I'm going to read 14 through 16. Matthew 21, verse 14. And the blind and the lame came in the temple, and he healed them. And when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased. Now, before I get to the end of this, I want you to see, number one, these people came with problems. You know what? I'm convinced in a number as few as we have this morning that some of you came with problems. Now, you might not have been blind, although I think sometimes we're spiritually blind.
Amen. Yeah.
And I'm talking to the redeemed. Mm-hmm. You know what? I know the lost are spiritually blind. Mm-hmm. I know that. But sometimes the redeemed are spiritually blind. And they can't see things for what they are. And we need some help. And so he says that the blind were brought to him and placed before him. And then notice what it says, and the chief priest saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Now, I want you to notice two things. And again, I have to take the Bible for what it says. And who did it say praised him? The children. And you know why the children were willing to do it? They weren't embarrassed. They weren't worried about what Aunt Sally would think of them. They weren't worried that the priest would look down his nose. And see, what we do as the Lord's people over the years, we begin to think more of what other people think than what God thinks. Yeah. We begin to think about what, you know, well-meaning preachers have said and taught for gospel truth when it's nothing more than their ideas. right? That's why children were able to do it. They hadn't been caught up in that yet. They hadn't been ingrained in what people thought was right. So they were saying, Hosanna. Blessed be the name of the Lord. High, lifted up, and mighty are his ways. They were praising him. Verse 16. And said unto him, Hearest thou what these say? And Jesus saith unto them, Yea, have you read out of the mouth of babes and sucklings thou hast perfected praise? So out of the little ones, and you know what? I began to think about this, and you know what? That also is this. People that are newly saved have more zeal and have more interest and have more verbal praise to God than those of us that have been saved 30 and 40 years, right, and almost too embarrassed to even say so. Babes and sucklings. You know what? We need to get back to just being babes in Christ. And be willing to praise him just for who he is. Just because he doeth all things well. That is where we need to be as the Lord's people. And I do want you to see, when you do that, you will be criticized. Because the religious elite of the day, the Jews, the Sanhedrin, they criticized him. Said, you know, you see what these people are doing? They look foolish. Gospel of Luke, chapter 1. Luke, chapter 1, verse 46. I'm sorry, verse 64. My dyslexia kicking in. Luke 1, verse 64. And his mouth was opened immediately, and his tongue was loosed, and he spake and praised God. Now, a couple of things about this. First of all, he was talking about the deaf, dumb boy that could not speak. Not really, well, I'll say this, he was mute. And there is a difference between being mute and being deaf. I don't know, he may have heard language perfectly. But when anybody ever muted their TV when the phone rang, it shuts them up, right? And they're still doing all this, and you watch it. But you can't hear nothing. The mute was shut up. And those that are spiritually dead, the lost, and those that are spiritually Sanhedrin, oh, I'm too good to do that, they're mute. Too embarrassed to say Hosanna. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Too embarrassed to lift holy hands. But you see, this newly converted, this newly healed, this new individual, he wasn't like that. He was happy and glad, and his mouth was open immediately, and his tongue was loose. And what? And he spake and praised God. See, wasn't upset at all, wasn't embarrassed about the situation, but gave God great praise simply for healing his body. Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. Luke 19. I'm going to begin reading in verse 36. Luke 19. Beginning in verse 36. The Bible says, And he went, and they spread their clothes in the way. Now this was a week before the crucifixion. And our Lord Jesus was coming down the mountain on the little colt. And they were spread their clothes before him. As he came off that mountain, and it was going to be trodden under the little colt. And they didn't care. You know what? It's a form of praise. It's a form of sacrifice. Sister Joanne, she claims it's not a new dress, but she's got a pretty dress on this morning. Can you imagine laying that and let a horse tranquilly? My wife has a new to her dress, too. Just trampled under. And why? Because of the goodness of God. Because he's worthy. He should be lifted up. He should be praised. And so they weren't embarrassed. And I could go deeper, and I won't for time's sake this morning. excuse me, but clothes has always been a means of praise to God. If you wear what you're supposed to wear, modest, and it pertains to your sex, that's a praise to God. And it always will be throughout the ceaseless ages. Verse 37, and when he was come nigh, even at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen. Now, did you get that? They all began to praise as a group, and the things they've seen. I saw the 5,000 fed. I saw the lame made to walk. I've seen the blind caused to see. I've seen the lips of the mute loosed up. I've seen it all. And they give him great praise and great honor. You know what? There is where we should be. If you want to praise him, highlight your life and say, listen, I want to praise you for this, and I want to praise you for that. Praise him. You know what? You don't have to be embarrassed to nobody. You really don't. Just praise him for who he is and what he's done in your life, and give him great glory and great honor simply for whom he is. Saying, blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he answered and said unto them, I tell you, that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. And you know what? They would have. And I believe the stones, in one sense, today are crying out and saying, hey, there was a Noah flood.
That's right. Yeah.
They're crying out and says, the Egyptians were at the bottom of the Red Sea.
Yeah.
But you know what? In this situation, I believe them little rocks would begin to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. High and lofty are you. Because you know what? If he can make an ass to speak, he can make anybody he wants to, anything he wants to praise his holy name. Isn't it sad that sometimes he has to use the rocks instead of us? Isn't it a sorrowful thing that we don't do enough praise to, that something is insignificant and is inanimate as a tree, has to praise him instead? That's a shame to the Lord's people. And we see that today, and seemingly more and more and more. That is the situation that we find ourselves in, is that we're giving over our praise to things that don't even have a living, breathing ability within them. Romans chapter 2. Personally believe that Rome is the church that defected. They gave up on truth. They wanted to embellish and bring in other people. Constantine the Great was just one of the many individuals that brought down the church at Rome until you find what we have today, that feel like they have to go through someone else, i.e. their priest or their pope, to praise God. That church, I want you to see that as he writes this, Romans chapter 2, verse 29, the Bible says, and he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and the circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. Now, what he's saying here is, listen, it doesn't have anything to do with circumcision anymore. The praise is this: do you know God? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you know the person of the Holy Ghost? Do you know what that Bible teaches concerning redemption? Do you know what that Bible teaches regarding salvation? And listen, don't get the two confused. Redemption and salvation are not the same. Redemption is the buyback price, the blood of our dear Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Salvation is the event in your life when He comes to you and say, hey, you're one of mine. They are different. Predestination and salvation are different too. Predestination is this. She's one of mine. Salvation may be 3,000 years down the road when your ungodly soul is saved. See the difference? See, that's a problem with many so-called Baptist churches today. We've got so hung up on election and predestination, we don't preach anything else, when what sinners need to hear is there's a Savior. And He says, the Bible says, whomsoever will. Are they contradictory? No. Because see, we don't know the elect. We're told to go into all the world and preach the gospel. That's all we're told to do, is it not? The death, burial, and resurrection of our dear Savior. That's all you need to know. He is a Savior. He can get the work done. And because He can, He deserves praise.
That's right.
He's entitled to anything that we can give Him. If it be our time, our money. You know why the Lord told them, whoever hath forsaken not houses and lands and mother and father and brother, sisters for my sake, for my name's sake. The reason He taught them that was to prioritize your needs. You know what He said concerning our needs? With food and raiment, be there with content. I got a house. I've got a truck. Donna has a car. Sarah has a car. Fixing the rain. We're going to go home and we're going to get under a good roof that don't leak. That's far more than He promised, is it not? But what if He said tomorrow, Larry, you go to South America, you sell everything you've got, and you head out. Would I be willing to do it? To go into the uncertainty of a country that I know nothing or next to nothing about, and give up a home? I've lived in that house 20 years. You know, that's the most time I've ever lived in one house in my whole life. It's a lot of security there for me. I could walk with my eyes closed in any room in that house and tell you where I'm at. But you know what? I should be able to lay it on the altar. And you know why? That's praiseworthy. That's saying, your ways are better than my ways. That's saying, this junk that we take so much stability in really is nothing.
Yeah.
And so we say, we see then that as the Lord Jesus Christ is teaching through the person of Paul this church, that they ought to praise Him just for who He is, just for what He does. Ephesians, last place. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 12. Now, if you read this whole chapter, it is all on predestination and election. It gives great glory and honor and praise that salvation lies only in the person of Christ. Right? But notice verse 12. That we should be to the praise of His glory, who first trusted in Christ. Now, I want you to notice two things about those verses. Number one, the part where you trust in Christ. Now, some sovereign gracers have about left that one out. But I want you to see, it says, to the praise and glories of those who trusted in Christ. Now, are you trusting in Christ? Because that is a huge, huge question. Do you trust Him significantly? Do you trust Him fully with the contents of your very being, which the only thing you really have is your soul? Do you trust Him with that?
Yeah.
I trust Him so much with that.
I would swing across the lake of fire on a dry cornstalk. But you know why? Because he's able. That's trust. That is trusting him exactly where we need to live. So after giving this long dissertation on predestination, he pretty much says it's about trust. Do you trust him? Do you know it? You know, to trust someone, you have to know them. You have to know who they are and what they're about and what they do. To trust them, really. And so we see then that we as the Lord's people, it comes down to you. Do you trust him or do you partially trust him? That we should be to the praise of his glory. Now that's the part that we really don't do that well today with, is to the praise of his glory. Do we don't, and glory is that illuminating light, that everything that has a glory illuminates that around him, to the praise of his glory. Now, do you praise him? That's the real essence. Do you praise? Do you lift him up? Do you say that he is high and holy above all things? He is gracious. He's my redeemer. He's the reason I get up in the morning and the reason I go to bed at night. He is my all in all. That's praiseworthy. That's something that every man and woman who's genuinely been saved, it's the responsibility. It's, you know, we almost treat it as optional today. But if you're too self-righteous to praise the Lord, make your common election short. Best advice I can give you.